The Book of Enoch, found within the Dead Sea Scrolls, quoted by Jude, taught from by Peter and our Messiah, this great text was preserved for the end times generation, a guidebook for those coming out of Mystery Babylon, coming out of Egypt and her ways into the true service of our Elohim. Join us as we read through and study this amazing gift, line by line. Shabbat shalom, brothers and sisters. Welcome back. Welcome to the Parable of Vineyard YouTube live stream. My name is Adam, your host, and we are at part six of our Enoch line by line series. Today, we're going to cover one chapter, chapter 24. We're going to be discussing the seven mountains and New Jerusalem. There's a lot to cover, so let's get started with some prayer, then a good shofar blast, and we're going to get right into it. Heavenly Father, Yahuwah Most High, we come before you and bless you and praise you in Yahushua's name. Thank you for waking us up in these last days to your truth, to your true Son. Thank you for opening our eyes to the wondrous things written in your Torah. Father, we thank you for books like Enoch and many others that you've opened for us in these last days to fit all the puzzle pieces of this end times that's just so massive. Father, we thank you so much, and may you continue to open our eyes and ears to your word that we may hear it and be doers and hearers. Father, we love you in Yahushua's mighty name. Amen. Shabbat shalom, best day of the week. Let's go with a shofar blast. All right, so here we are at Enoch chapter 24. Just in case you're catching this as the first time, we are reading through the R.H. Charles version. If you have the Sefer version, sometimes the chapters don't always quite line up. So with that, let's get right into it because we have a lot to cover. And here we go. What I'm going to do is I'm going to read all of 24, and then we're going to kind of go back and kind of go through this piece by piece and figure out exactly what these seven mountains are, what they represent, and we're going to be going back to the other seven mountains that we saw in Enoch 18 last week. Last week, I mentioned, hey, we're going to be talking about this in the future, and here we are in the future talking about it. So, here we go. Enoch 24, and from thence I went to another place of the earth, and he showed me a mountain range of fire which burnt day and night. And I went beyond it and saw seven magnificent mountains, all differing each from the other, and the stones thereof were magnificent and beautiful, magnificent as a whole, of glorious appearance and fair exterior, three towards the east, one founded on the other, and three towards the south, one upon the other, and deep rough ravines, no one of which joined with any other. And the seventh mountain was in the midst of these, and it excelled them in height, resembling the seat of a throne. And fragrant trees encircled the throne, and amongst them was a tree such as I have never yet smelt. Neither was any amongst them, nor were there others like it. It had a fragrance beyond all fragrance, and its leaves and blooms and wood wither not forever. And its fruit is beautiful, and its fruit resembles the date of a palm. Then I said, how beautiful is this tree, and fragrant, and its leaves are fair, and its blooms very delightful in appearance. Then answered Michael, one of the holy and honored angels who was with me and was their leader. So let's go through this and let's dive into the word and let's go on a journey here to find out what exactly these seven mountains are. So one thing before we get into, we'll have to remember is a lot of times we see there's light and darkness, just like on the day one, right? The Most High separated the light from the darkness. And there's a kingdom of light and there is a kingdom of darkness on this earth. And that's kind of what we're going to see here. We saw the seven mountains here of just pure beauty and excellency. And, well, I'm kind of alluding to it already. These seven mountains are part of the heavenly kingdom. And last week in chapter 18, we read about the seven burning mountains, these angels that were buried and burning with fire. That's part of the beast kingdom. And that actually goes into play with what's written in Revelation. So let's get into it. So first, let's go back to last week and let's read a little bit of Enoch chapter 18. We're going to read verses 9 through 16. And I saw a flaming fire, and beyond these mountains is a region, the end of the great earth. There the heavens were completed, and I saw a deep abyss with columns of heavenly fire, and among them I saw columns of fire fall, which were beyond measure, like toward the height and towards the depth. And beyond that abyss I saw a place which had no firmament of the heaven above, and no firmly founded earth beneath it. There was no water upon it, and no birds, but it was a waste and horrible place. And there I saw seven stars like great burning mountains. And to me, when I inquired regarding them, the angel said, "This place is the end of heaven and earth. This has become a prison for the stars and the host of heaven. And the stars which roll over the fire are they which have transgressed the commandment of Yahuwah in the beginning of their rising, because they did not come forth at their appointed times. And he was wroth with them and bound them till the time when their guilt should be consummated, even for 10,000 years." So we have two sets of mountains, or seven mountains, right? Anyway, as we read in 24, we have these mountains with that are beautiful and magnificent and of beautiful exterior. And in 18, we see these seven mountains in a place which was, he said, was a waste and horrible place. So, of course, we have the seven mountains of light and seven mountains of darkness. So let's go back. Here in chapter 18, verses 5 through 8, we get an earlier vision of these seven good mountains. So, verse 5, "I saw the winds on the earth carrying the clouds. I saw the paths of the angels. I saw at the end of the earth the firmament of the heaven above. And I proceeded and saw a place which burns day and night, where there are seven mountains of magnificent stones, three towards the east and three towards the south. And as for those towards the east, one was of colored stone, and one of pearl, and one of jacinth, and those towards the south of red stone. But the middle one reached to heaven like the throne of Elohim of alabaster, and the summit of the throne was of sapphire." Now, doing a study on the colors, or the stone sapphire, is amazing in and of itself. Just to give you an idea, the Ten Commandments, I think we all have this picture in our mind that it's just like this bland stone. It's just rock, and it's carved in rock. Actually, if you dig into the Hebrew, it actually was sapphire stones. The Ten Commandments were engraven on sapphire. Also, we find in the book of Ezekiel that the firmament has the likeness of sapphire. It's made out of sapphire, actually. In the book of the book of Yashar, we find that the rod, the stick of Elohim, was actually sapphire. The throne of Elohim is sapphire, as we see here. And it's interesting that those of you that have read the book of Numbers, chapter 15, there's a commandment given to wear these tzitzit, these strings that hang from your pants or your garment. And it has that deep blue color resembling that sapphire. So just some interesting things. We can go a lot further into that, but that's for another time. We have other things to cover tonight. But just amazing, this color sapphire. So in chapter 18, we see both the seven good mountains and the seven bad mountains. So let's get into the book of Revelation, where this becomes important, of understanding these seven mountains. Revelation 12, 3 through 4. "And there appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon, having seven heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his heads." And so the seven mountains are going to become important when we talk about these seven heads. So the dragon, Satan, has seven heads and 10 horns. "And his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born." So what's interesting about the book of Revelation, especially chapters 12 and 13, there's so much in Enoch that decodes what's actually happening in the book of Revelation. And can't spoil it today, but a lot of you may have seen the study we've done on the stars of heaven. So when the book of Revelation is talking about him drawing the third part of the stars of heaven, well, we need to know what the stars of heaven actually represent. Most people would say angels, but there's so much to that. But we're actually going to be going over that when we go over Enoch chapter 43. If you want to learn a little bit about it now, you can search on YouTube, Parable of the Vineyard, Enoch 43, Identity of the Stars in Heaven Revealed. It's something like that. You'll find it with those search terms. Anyways, but you know, with things like stars of heaven and seven heads, ten horns, well, we got to know what's actually going on here. We need to know the keys to decrypting these parables, because we know Messiah walked around and taught parables. Some of the parables that he revealed, some of the parables he kept hidden. You don't think the book of Revelation is packed with parables and I'd say riddles, but parables, right? And to understand the parables, you have to understand what these words actually mean. And so we're going to define these seven heads tonight. All right, so let's go now to Revelation 17, 9 through 10. And here is the mind which has wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains. Hello. That's going to come into play tonight with our study. We're talking about the seven mountains, seven good mountains, seven bad mountains. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sits, and there are seven kings. Five are fallen, one is, and the other is not yet come, and when he comes, he must continue a short space. So we can see already the book of Revelation is very important. I'm sorry, the book of Enoch is extremely important with understanding what's going on in the book of Revelation. So again, remember, there appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon, which is unequivocally Satan. The book of Revelation tells us the dragon is literally Satan. So Satan has seven heads. Seven heads are seven mountains, and these seven mountains are also seven kings. We're gonna get a little deeper into that. So Daniel 10, 12 through 13, this is when Daniel was praying, and as Daniel prayed, the angel Gabriel came to speak with him. And this is the angel Gabriel speaking. Then he said unto me, "Fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that you did set your heart to understand and to chasten yourself before your Elohim, your words were heard, and I am come for your words. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 120 days. But lo, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, and I remained there with the kings of Persia." So one thing we have to often understand here, I want to share with you, let's see. This is the word used for prince. It's tsar, which means prince, ruler, leader, chief, chieftain, vassal, noble, captain, general, commander, chief, head, overseer, elder. So there's many definitions here for prince. Let's keep going here. Daniel 10:20-21. Then said he, "Knowest you wherefore I come unto you? And now will I return to fight with the prince of Persia. And when I am gone forth, lo, the prince of Grecia shall come. But I will show you that which is noted in the scripture of truth. And there is none that holds with me in these things but Michael, your prince." Michael is the chief archangel over the people of Israel. So let's read this from Isaiah 10. And so remember, what we're talking about here is the great red dragon has seven heads. These seven heads are seven mountains, and seven mountains are also seven kings. You might be asking yourself, well, why are we talking about princes if we're talking about kings here? Isaiah 10, 1 through 9. "Woe unto them that decree unrighteous decrees, and that write grievousness which they have prescribed, to turn aside the needy from judgment, and to take away the right from the poor of my people, that widows may be their prey, and that they may rob the fatherless. And what will you do in the day of visitation, and in the desolation which shall come from far? To whom will you flee to help? And where will you leave your glory? Without me they shall bow down under the prisoners, and they shall fall under the slain. For all this his anger is not turned away, but his hand is stretched out still. O Assyrian, the rod of mine anger, and the staff in their hand is my indignation. I will send him against an hypocritical nation, and against the people of my wrath will I give him a charge, to take the spoil, and to take the prey, and to tread them down like the mire of the streets. Howbeit he means not so, neither does his heart think so. But it is in his heart to destroy and to cut off nations, not a few. For he says, are not my princes altogether kings? And so these angels that are princes are also kings. These are leaders. These are rulers over certain territories. So let's take interesting turn here. So who are some of these leaders, some of these kings? Well, Psalm 82, Elohim stands in the congregation of the mighty. These are Elohim, these are gods. So basically in English, it's saying God stands in the congregation of the gods, plural. Elohim stands in the congregation of the multiple Elohim. He judges among the Elohim. How long will you judge unjustly and accept the persons of the wicked, Selah? Defend the poor and the fatherless, to do justice do justice to the afflicted and needy. And this is what it's talking. This is who he's originally talking about here in Isaiah 10, right? To turn aside the needy from judgment and to take away the right from the poor of my people. He's talking still to these Elohim, these rulers, these powers and principalities and spiritual wickedness in high places, right? Elohim stands in the congregation of the mighty. He judges among the Elohim. How long will he judge unjustly and accept the persons of the wicked, Selah? Defend the poor and fatherless. Do justice to the afflicted and needy. Deliver the poor and needy. Rid them out of the hand of the wicked. They know not, neither will they understand. They will walk on in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are out of course. I have said, you are gods, you are Elohim, and all of you are the children of the Most High. But you shall die like men and fall like one of the princes. Arise, O Elohim, judge the earth, for you shall inherit all nations. So let's talk about this a little bit further. This was actually kind of tucked away and hidden. Most people don't see this. In the book of Deuteronomy, in the Masoretic text, it's, let me pull it up so you can see it in both. Deuteronomy 32. So in Deuteronomy 32, verse 8, it says, when the Most High divided the nations, their inheritance, when he separated the sons of Adam, he set the bounds of the people according to the number of the children of Israel, which is not true. In the Septuagint, it actually shows you what's going on here. When the Most High divided the nations, when he separated the sons of Adam, he set the bounds of the nations according to the number of the angels of Elohim. And there's 70 nations, and actually Israel is the 71st nation. And that, what we saw in Daniel, what we saw in the book of Daniel here, it says, but Michael, your prince. Michael is the archangel, is the angel that's the leader over the nation of Israel. Whereas you have these other 70 angels that are mentioned here in Isaiah 10, saying that all are my princes, not altogether kings. And also in Psalm 82, when he's talking about the congregation of the Elohim. Hopefully this is still making sense. Now let's take a look at the book of Yashar, chapter 9. We're going to look at verses 31 through 32. And we're going to see here these 70 Elohim, these 70 princes or kings. And they built a tower in the city, and they did this thing daily until many days and years were elapsed. This, of course, is the building of the Tower of Babel. And Elohim said to the 70 angels who stood foremost before him, to those who were near to him, saying, come, let us descend and confuse their tongues, that one man shall not understand the language of his neighbor. And they did so unto them. And so from the Tower of Babel, from the one language went 70 languages, went to 70 nations. You have these 70 princes, aka these 70 kings, these angels that are ruling over each nation. That's what was going on here in the book of Daniel, right? When he said, one of the chief princes came to help me, and I remained there with the king of Persia. And that's, but the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 1 and 21 days. That's what he's talking about. He's talking about one of these Elohim, right? Because there's no earthly prince or king that's gonna stop an angel from doing what they want, what they need to do. It's, of course, it'd be another spiritual entity, one of these 70, all right, that withstood them. So that's what's going on here. And just one last confirmation: the Targums, Targums chapter 11. This, of course, is the Aramaic. We're gonna look at chapter 11, verses 5 through 9. And Yahuwah was revealed to punish them for the work of the city and the tower which the sons of men built. And Yahuwah said, behold, the people are one, and the language of all of them is one. And this they have thought to do, and now they will not be restrained from doing whatever they imagine. And Yahuwah said to the 70 messengers, or angels, which stand before him, come, we will descend and intermix their language, that a man will not understand the speed of his neighbor. And the word of Yahuwah, who is Messiah, was revealed against the city, and with him 70 angels, having reference to 70 nations, each having its own language, and then the writing of his own hand, and he dispersed them from them upon the face of all the earth into 70 languages, and one did not know what his neighbor was saying, but one slew the other, and they ceased from building the city. So, let's go back now to here. So right now we're back in Revelation. Let's read Revelation 17 again now. And there came one of the seven angels, which had the seven vials, and talked with me. Actually, you know what? I'm sorry. One more thing about these 70 angels. We're going to look at Enoch 89. So we're going to skip probably a couple months ahead here. We're going to read Enoch 89, 51 through 90. And we're going to see the judgment of these 70 angels. And what we're looking at here, this is the dream vision of Enoch. This is probably one of the most intriguing parts of the book of Enoch, where Enoch is literally shown the entire history of man from the beginning, Adam and Eve, all the way to literally the end times, the millennial reign, everything. And it's fascinating. So here we are, the two kingdoms, right? The two kingdoms of Israel and Judah and the destruction of Jerusalem. And again, I saw those sheep, that they again erred and went many ways. Of course, the sheep is his people. And forsook that their house. And Yahuwah of the sheep called some of them from amongst the sheep and sent them to the sheep. But the sheep began to slay them. Of course, this is the prophets. This is him sending the prophets. But the sheep began to slay the prophets. And one of them was saved and was not slain, Elijah. And it sped away and cried aloud over the sheep. And they sought to slay it. But Yahuwah the sheep saved it from the sheep and brought it up to me and caused it to dwell there. And many other sheep he sent to those sheep to testify unto them and lament over them. And after that I saw when they forsook the house of Yahuwah, and his tower fell away entirely, and their eyes were blinded. And I saw Yahuwah of the sheep, how he wrought much slaughter amongst them in their herds, until those sheep invited that slaughter and betrayed his place. And he gave them over into the hands of the lions and the tigers and the wolves and the hyenas. These are different nations. And into the hands of the foxes and to all the wild beasts. And those wild beasts began to tear in pieces those sheep. And I saw that he forsook that their house and their tower and gave them all into the hand of the lions to tear and devour them into the hand of all the wild beasts. These are all the foreign nations. And I began to cry aloud with all my power, and to appeal to Yahuwah the sheep, and to represent to him in regard to all the sheep that they were devoured by all the wild beasts, but he remained unmoved. Though he saw it, and rejoiced that they were devoured, and swallowed, and robbed, and left them to be devoured in the hand of all the beasts. And he called 70 shepherds, these are the 70 angels, and cast those sheep to them, that they might pasture them. And he spake to the shepherds and their companions, let each individual of you pasture the sheep henceforward, and everything that I shall command you, that do ye. So this is when the Most High cast them off from being a nation, and now they are spread off into the other nations. So these 70 Elohim, these 70 princes or kings, are now overseers of his people. Because he's spreading them into the other nations. Because you've got like the king of Persia, you got the king of Babylon, you got the king of Tyre, and you know that's what's interesting is why so many times it sounds like Yahuwah is rebuking Satan, but he's saying he's using the cover of like the king of Tyre. Well, it's because these Elohim have the governance over these nations. And I will deliver them over unto you duly numbered, and tell you which of them are to be destroyed, and then be destroyed. And he gave over them unto them those sheep, and he called another and spake unto him, observe and mark everything that the shepherds will do to those sheep, for they will destroy more of them than I have commanded them. So the Most High gave Yah's people into the hands of these shepherds and said, hey, these are the ones to kill, these are the ones I want you to keep alive. But he's saying, hey, he's telling this scribe that, hey, I know they're going to kill more than I prescribe them. They're going to disobey me. And every excess and the destruction which will be wrought through the shepherds, record, namely, how many they destroy according to my command, and how many according to their own caprice, right, to their own mind. Record against every individual shepherd all the destruction he effects, and read out before me by number how many they destroy, and how many they deliver over for destruction, that I may have this as a testimony against them, and know every deed of the shepherds, that I may comprehend and see what they do, whether or not they abide by my command which I have commanded them. But they shall not know it, and thou shalt not declare it to them, nor admonish them, but only record against each individual all the destruction which the shepherds effect each in his time, and lay it all before me. And I saw till those shepherds pastured in their season, and they began to slay and to destroy more than they were bidden, and they delivered those sheep into the hand of the lions, and the lions and the tigers ate and devoured the greater part of those sheep, and the wild boars ate along with them, and they burnt that tower and demolished that house. And I became exceedingly sorrowful over that tower, because that house of the sheep was demolished, and afterwards I was unable to see those sheep enter that house. And the shepherds and their associates delivered over those sheep and all the wild beasts to devour them, and each one of them received in his time a definite number. It was written by the other in a book how many each one of them destroyed of them. And each one slew and destroyed many more than was prescribed, and began to weep and lament on account of those sheep. So these rulers, these 70 rulers, are ruling against the will of Elohim. They're disobedient to his commandment. And thus in the vision I saw that one who wrote, how he wrote down every one that was destroyed by those shepherds day by day, and carried up and laid down and showed actually the whole book to Yahuwah of the sheep, even everything that they had done, and all that each one of them had made away with, and all that they had given over to destruction. And the book was read before Yahuwah of the sheep, and he took the book from his hand and read it and sealed it and laid it down. And forthwith I saw how the shepherds pastured for 12 hours, and behold, three of those sheep turned back and came and entered and began to build up all that had fallen down of that house. But the wild, this is the time of course, Nehemiah, Ezra. And the wild boars tried to hinder them. This is the Edomites, but they were not able. And they began to build as before, and they reared up that tower, and it was named the High Tower. And they began again to place a table before the tower, but all the bread on it was polluted and not pure. And as touching all this, the eyes of those sheep were blinded, so that they saw not, and the eyes of their shepherds likewise. And they delivered them in large numbers to the shepherds for destruction. And they trampled the sheep with their feet and devoured them. And Yahuwah of the sheep remained unmoved till all the sheep were dispersed over the field and mingled with them. And they, the shepherds, did not save them out of the hands of the beasts. And this one who wrote the book carried it up and showed it and read it before Yahuwah the sheep, and implored him on their account and besought him on their account, as he showed him all the doings of the shepherds and gave testimony before him against all the shepherds. And he took the actual book and laid it down beside him and departed. And let's see. I thought there was more. Oh, yeah. Okay. So then 90... We're at chapter 90, verses 1 through 5. And I saw till that in this manner 35 shepherds undertook the pasturing of the sheep, and they severally completed their periods as did the first, and others received them into their hand to pasture them for their period, each shepherd in his own period. And it's interesting that we see this in the book of Revelation, that, where was it? Right, so there are seven kings, five are fallen, one is, and the other is not yet come. And when he comes, he must continue a short space. So they each have their time period. And after that, I saw in my vision all the birds of heaven coming, the eagles, the vultures, the kites, the ravens. But the eagles led all the birds, and they began to devour their sheep and to pick out their eyes and to devour their flesh. And the sheep cried out because their flesh was being devoured by the birds. And as for me, I looked and lamented in my sleep over that shepherd who pastured the sheep. And I saw until those sheep were devoured by the dogs, the eagles, the kites, and they left neither flesh nor skin nor sinew remaining on them till their bones stood there, and their bones too fell to the earth, and the sheep became few. And I saw until that 23 had undertaken the pasturing and completed in their several periods 58 times. So this is talking about different shepherds, doing basically having their time. Now, we're going to skip down to verse 21. Where are we at here? Actually, verse 20. And I saw till a throne was erected in the pleasant land, and Yahweh the sheep sat himself thereon, and the other took the sealed books and opened those books before Yahweh the sheep. And Yahweh called those men, those seven first white ones, these are the, we'll see, these are the good mountains, and commanded they should bring before him, beginning with the first star, which led all the way, all the stars, whose privy members were like those of horses, and they brought them all before him. And he said to that man who rode before him, being one of those seven white ones, and said unto him, take, which I believe is Michael, take those 70 shepherds, to whom I delivered the sheep, and who, taking them under their own authority, slew more than I commanded them. And behold, they were all bound, and I saw, and they all stood before him. And the judgment was held first over the stars, and they were judged and found guilty, and went to the place of condemnation. And they were cast into an abyss, full of fire and flaming and full of pillars. And those 70 shepherds were judged and found guilty, and they were cast into that fiery abyss. Kind of like what we see in Enoch 18, right? The place of this horrible waste and horrible place in this deep abyss. There he saw seven stars like great burning mountains, right? This is the prison for the stars and the host of heaven. And you see these 70 shepherds go to the same place. All right. And, let's see. Oh, I want to read this through verse 36. And I saw that time how a like abyss was opened in the midst of the earth, full of fire, and they brought those blinded sheep, and they were all judged and found guilty and cast into this fiery abyss, and they burned. Now this abyss was to the right of that house. And we see this also in Matthew 25, where he says to the goats, depart into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. So remember, as we started this portion off, the great red dragon, right, the devil, having his seven heads and 10 horns. So he's got his, he has basically his hierarchy, his structure, his officers, if you will. And I saw those sheep burning and their bones burning. And I stood up to see till they folded up that house and carried off all the pillars and all the beams and ornaments of the house were at the same time folded up with it. And they carried it off and laid it in a place in the south of the land. And I saw till Yahweh the sheep brought a new house, greater and loftier than the first, and set it up in the place of the first, which had been folded up. All its pillars were new, and its ornaments were new and larger than those of the first, the old one which he had taken away, and all the sheep were within it. And I saw till all the sheep which had been left, and all the beasts on the earth, and all the birds of heaven, falling down and doing homage to those sheep, and making petition to and obeying them in everything. And thereafter those three who were... Huh, that's interesting. It talks about, I didn't notice this before, but all the sheep which had been left... and the beasts of the earth. So we have believers and the nations and all the birds of heaven falling down and doing homage to those sheep, which were the righteous ones. That's interesting. And making petition to and obeying them in everything. And thereafter those three who were clothed in white and had seized me by my hand, who had taken me up before, and the hand of that ram also seizing hold of me, they took me up and set me down in the midst of those sheep before the judgment took place. And those sheep were all white, and their wool was abundant and clean. And all that had been destroyed and dispersed, and all the beasts of the field, and all the birds of heaven assembled in the house. And Yahweh of the sheep rejoiced with great joy because they were all good and had returned to his house. And that's just, oh man, that could be a deep dive in and of itself. That it says that the righteous returned to his house. So they were there at one time. This kind of goes back to what we were discussing when we were in chapters 15 and 16, talking about the wall, essentially the wall of New Jerusalem, and the tongues of fire, and the stones of crystal and of different colors. It's interesting that it's possible that those that will return to his house were originally there. It's interesting too, because one thing I've been seeing, I saw this really at Sukkot, and really over the last couple of years, as I continue to meet other like-minded believers. And when I say like-minded believers, I'm talking about people that are being woken up to the deceptions of this world, being brought back to the Father through the true Messiah. And I say the true Messiah, the lawful Messiah, not the Messiah that's like just the fun-loving hippie that did away with the Torah and just is like, hey, I just said love, man, love. You know, that's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the true Messiah, the lawful one. And realizing that our faith is to consist of our belief is to consist of faith and works. When I start to meet some of these people, there's like this familiarity, almost like we knew each other beforehand somehow. Like we're like good buddies. Like there's no awkward like getting to know you. Like, oh hey, how's it going? It's like instant best buds. It's just interesting. So I wonder if it'll be something like that that'll be revealed. Like, we all did know each other before all this started. You know, I don't know. It's just an interesting thought. And I saw it till they laid down that sword, which had been given to the sheep, and they brought it back into the house, and it was sealed before the presence of Yahuwah, and all the sheep were invited into that house, but it held them not. And the eyes of them were all opened, and they saw the good, and there was not one among them that did not see. And I saw to that house, that house, it was very large and broad and very full. Pretty cool. So kind of getting a little off topic here, but hey, this is good stuff. We're going to read it. And then lastly, what am I actually getting at here? Maybe you're kind of like, okay, this is all cool, but what are you actually talking about here? So the devil has 7 heads, 10 horns, right? These 7 heads are 7 mountains. These 7 mountains are also signified 7 kings. Who are these 7 kings? Well, I believe it's part of these 70 angels that pasture in their time, in their seasons over time, right? So they basically have their time and they're done. They have their time and they're done. And so it looks like in these last days, there's these 7 angels that rule with him. And let me kind of back that up here. Interestingly enough, in Enoch 56, we're going to read verses 5 through 8. And in those days the angels shall return and hurl themselves to the east upon the Parthians and the Medes. They shall stir up the kings so that a spirit of unrest shall come upon them, and they shall rouse them from their thrones, that they may break forth as lions from their lairs. It's interesting, you know, we were just reading about Enoch, how the sheep got thrown to the lions. And as hungry wolves among their flocks, and they shall go up and tread underfoot the land of his elect ones, and the land of his elect ones shall be before them a threshing floor and a highway. But the city of my righteous shall be a hindrance to their horses, and they shall begin to fight amongst themselves. Now we're looking at Revelation stuff. And their right hand shall be strong against themselves, and no man shall know his brother, nor his son, his father, or his mother, till there be no number of corpses through their slaughter, and the punishment may be not in vain. In those days Sheol shall open its jaws, and they shall be swallowed up therein, and their destruction shall be at an end, and Sheol shall devour the sinners in the presence of the elect. So this is basically kind of summarizing it here. Some of the angels are going to come back. They're going to lead some of these nations to war against Yahusha and his elect, and they're going to be thrown into the fire. That's the short and skinny of it. And you're kind of going to be like, well, that's not really new information. Yeah, maybe not, maybe so. But I really believe that Enoch kind of expounds exactly really what these 7 mountains represent. And so, I just find that it really just, I don't know, just gives us the finer details of what's going on in Revelation. Probably the most cryptic book in history. And these 7 mountains are an interesting key to figure out exactly what's going on. So let's keep going, though. Let's read Revelation 17. And there came one of the 7 angels with the seven vials and talked with me, saying unto me, Come hither, and I will show unto you the judgment of the great whore that sits upon many waters, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast full of names of blasphemy, having seven heads and ten horns. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones of pearls, having the golden cup in her hand full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Yahusha. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. Why would the prophet John look at this woman and look at her with admiration? I think there's been a lot of misunderstandings about the identity of Mystery Babylon in these last days. And I would highly encourage you to watch a certain video. Let me share it with you really quickly. There's actually a playlist, a whole playlist I'd recommend on the channel. Let's see here. So if you go to the main page, the home page of Parable of the Vineyard, you just scroll down. We have different playlists. And there's a playlist I'd highly recommend. This one right here called Mark of the Beast, Mystery Babylon, Antichrist, some hot topics that have been discussed for many years, of course. I would highly recommend this video right here called Mystery Babylon. Maybe even the Beast and Mystery Babylon together. One's 22 minutes, one is 35 minutes. It might put to the test what you currently believe Mystery Babylon is, but I would highly, highly encourage it. And the angel said to me, Wherefore did you marvel? Why did you marvel? I'll tell you the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carries her, which has seven heads and ten horns. The beast that you saw was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit. Right? Who's bound in the bottomless pit? Right? Who is returning? The angels. Oops, where are we? We're over here. And go into perdition, right? Who goes into perdition? And they that dwell on the earth shall wonder, whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they behold the beast that was and is not and yet is. You know, in thinking about these angelic beings, you know, if they were to come and return and make themselves manifest to men like they did thousands of years ago, what would the storyline be like? In my opinion, I think that's one of the biggest reasons for the massive success and fame of Hollywood series like the Marvel series, like the Avengers. You have these superheroes, they have these superpowers. And, you know, are these angels going to have superpowers? Yes. Is the world going to marvel at them? Yes, I believe so. Just like we see in, like, the Transformers series, you have the good Transformers and the bad Transformers. Well, of course, everything is flipped upside down, and you're going to have the bad angels. They're going to come and present themselves as the good angels, saying, hey, you know, this outside threat is going to come and want to destroy this earth, which is what Yahusha is going to come and do. It's his right. It's the judgment of this earth for its wickedness. But they're going to gather the kings of the earth together, right? And that's why the whole world is going to marvel and serve these people or these entities. And here is the mind which has wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sits. So it's interesting. We're going to talk about these seven hills. Actually, let's discuss that right now. Rotten Isle. So it's interesting because people would immediately say, Rome. Rome is a city on seven hills. Well, guess who else is sit on seven hills? Jerusalem. Jerusalem has seven hills. Kind of is important when we're talking about the identity of the whore. And there are seven kings, five are fallen, one is, and the other is not yet come. And when he comes, he must continue a short space. And the beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth and is of the seven and goes into perdition. Right? It's these angels who we read in the book of Enoch. they're going to be cast into the fire. Where was it? This place is the end of heaven. This has become a prison for the stars and the host of heaven. Great burning mountains. Right? These shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them, for he is Lord of lords. He is Adonai HaAdonim, and King of kings, and they that are with him are called and chosen and faithful. So it's interesting that at the time of this beast coming against the kingdom of Elohim, there are people that are with him who are called and chosen and faithful. Many are called, few are chosen. We've spoken quite about this over the last couple portions of this study about the righteous. Who are the righteous? Who are the called? Who are the chosen? And who are the faithful? All right, so let's go over this now. So these seven mountains, the bad ones, will tremble at his presence. And this is, if we understand these seven mountains to be seven of these angels, seven of Satan's angels, then this will make a lot more sense. Habakkuk 3, 1 through 10. A prayer of Habakkuk, the prophet, upon a Shigenoth. O Yahuwah, I have heard your speech and was afraid. O Yahuwah, revive your work in the midst of the years. In the midst of the years, make known. And wrath, remember mercy. Elohim came from Teman, and the Holy One from Mount Paran, Selah. His glory covered the heavens, and the earth was full of his praise, and his brightness was as the light. He had horns coming out of his hand, and there was the hiding of his power. Before him went the pestilence, and burning coals went forth at his feet. He stood and measured the earth, and beheld, and drove asunder the nations, and the everlasting mountains were scattered. The perpetual hills did bow. His ways are everlasting. I saw the tents of Cushan in affliction, and the curtains of the land of Midian did tremble. Was Yahuwah displeased against the rivers? Was your anger against the rivers? Was your wrath against the sea, that you did ride upon your horses and your chariots of salvation? Your bow was made quite... Now, of course, this is the day of Yahuwah, and also known as the day of the Lord. Your bow was made quite naked, according to the oaths of the tribes, even your word, Selah. You did cleave the earth with rivers. The mountains saw you, and they trembled. The overflowing of the water passed by. The deep uttered his voice and lifted up his hands on high. So these mountains saw the coming of Yahuwah and was like, oh boy, our time is up. Just like, remember when Legion saw Yahusha and they were like, ah, well, I don't know who you are. If you cast us out, cast us into these pigs. Have you come to destroy us before the time? They knew. Judges 5, 1 through 5, this is the song of Deborah and Barak. Then sang Deborah and Barak, the son of Abinoam, on that day, saying, praise ye Yahuwah for the avenging of Israel, when the people willingly offer themselves. Hear, O ye kings, give ear, O ye princes. Even I will sing unto Yahuwah. I will sing praise to Yahuwah of Israel. Yahuwah, when you went out of Seir, when you marched out of the field of Edom, the earth trembled, the heavens dropped, the clouds also dropped water. The mountains melted from before Yahuwah, even that Sinai from before the Elohim of Israel. And this takes us back to the very first chapter of Enoch, when it tells us plainly that the mountains will tremble, the angels will tremble. The words of the blessing of Enoch, wherewith he blessed the elect and righteous, who will be living in the day of tribulation, when all the wicked and godless are to be removed. And he took up his parable and said, Enoch, a righteous man, whose eyes were opened by Elohim, saw the vision of the Holy One in the heavens, which the angels showed me, and from them I heard everything, and from them I understood as I saw. But not for this generation, but for a remote one, a distant one, which is for to come, our generation. Concerning the elect, I said, and took up my parable concerning them. The Holy and the Great One will come forth from his dwelling, and the eternal Elohim will tread upon the earth, even on Mount Sinai, and appear from his camp, and appear in the strength of his might from the heaven of heavens, and all shall be smitten with fear, and the watchers shall quake. right? These angels in great fear and trembling shall seize them unto the ends of the earth, and the high mountains shall be shaken, and the high hills shall be made low, and shall melt like wax before the flame. Let's take a look at Enoch 52. Here's the seven mountains again. And after those days, in that place where I had seen all the visions of that which is hidden, for I had been carried off in a whirlwind, and they had borne me toward the west, there mine eyes saw all the secret things of heaven that shall be: a mountain of iron, a mountain of copper, and a mountain of silver, and a mountain of gold, and a mountain of soft metal, and a mountain of lead. And I asked the angel who went with me, saying, what things are these which I have seen in secret? And he said to me, all these things which you have seen shall serve the dominion of his anointed, that he may be potent and mighty on the earth. And the angel of peace answered, saying unto me, wait a little, and there shall be revealed unto you all the secret things which surround Yahweh Sabaoth. And these mountains which you have, your eyes have seen, the mountain of iron, the mountain of copper, and the mountain of silver, and the mountain of gold, and the mountain of soft metal, and the mountain of lead, all these shall be in the presence of the elect one as wax before the fire, and like water which streams down from above. And like the water which streams down from above upon these mountains, they shall become powerless before his feet. These are the mountains. These are the rulers, the kings, the princes that are ruling in the time of the end when Yahusha comes back. And it shall come to pass in those days that none shall be saved either by gold or by silver, and none shall be able to escape. And there shall be no iron for war, nor shall one clothe oneself with a breastplate. Bronze shall be of no service, and tin shall be of no service, and shall not be esteemed, and lead shall not be desired, and all these things shall be denied and destroyed from the surface of the earth when the elect one shall appear before the face of Yahweh Sabaoth. So this is when Messiah Yahusha returns. And so it's interesting, these mountains once again represent kings and kingdoms, and this kind of ties right into the Daniel 2 and Daniel 7 connection. This is when Daniel was interpreting the dream of Nebuchadnezzar, and he saw at least five of these metals. You, O king, saw and beheld a great image, this great image whose brightness was excellent stood before you, and the form thereof was terrible. This image's head was of fine gold, his breast and his arms of silver, his belly and his thighs of brass, his legs of iron, and his feet part of iron and part of clay. You saw till that a stone was cut out without hands. This is the kingdom, which smote the image upon his feet that were of iron and clay and brake them to pieces. Then was the iron, the clay, the brass, the silver, and the gold broken to pieces together and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floor. And the wind carried them away that no place was found for them. And the stone that smote the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. This is the dream, and we will tell the interpretation thereof before the king. You, O king, are a king of kings, for the Elohim of heaven has given you a kingdom, power, and strength, and glory. And wheresoever the children of men dwell, the beasts of the field and the fowls of the heaven has he given unto your hand, and has made you ruler over them all. You are this head of gold. And after you shall arise another kingdom inferior to you, and another third kingdom of brass, which shall bear rule over all the earth. And the fourth kingdom shall be as strong as iron, for as much as iron breaks in pieces and subdues all things, and as iron that breaks all these, shall it break in pieces and bruise. And whereas you saw the feet and toes, part of potter's clay and part of iron, the kingdom shall be divided. But there shall be in it the strength of the iron, for as much as you saw the iron mixed with miry clay. And as the toes of the feet were part of iron and part of clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly broken. And whereas you saw iron mixed with miry clay, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men, but they shall not cleave one to another, even as iron is not mixed with clay. And in the days of these kings, here we go, right, these metals, The Elohim of heaven shall set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed, and the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. Kind of like what we just saw right here. He's seeing these seven mountains of these metals, and at his presence, at his coming, at his presence, the presence of the elect one, and the mountain of gold and soft metal and lead, all these shall be in the presence of the elect one as wax before the fire. And they shall become powerless before his feet. So they're going to have a little time here to do their thing. But when he comes, it's over. Game's over. For as much as you saw that that stone was cut out of the mountain without hands, and that it break in pieces the iron, the brass, the clay, the silver, and the gold, the great Elohim has made unto the king what shall come to pass hereafter, and the dream is certain, and the interpretation thereof is sure. Also, in Daniel 7, these great beasts. So we're seeing mountains, we're seeing beasts, we're seeing these fine metals. What's going on here, right? All the same stuff. These great beasts, which are four kings, which shall or kingdoms, which shall arise out of the earth. But the saints of the Most High shall take the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever, even forever and ever. Then I would know the truth of the fourth beast, which is diverse from all the others, exceeding dreadful, whose teeth were of iron, and his nails of brass, which devoured, break in pieces, and stamped the residue with his feet. And of the 10 horns that were in his head, and of the other which came up, and before whom 3 fell, even of that horn that had eyes and a mouth that spoke very great things, whose look was more stout than his fellows, I beheld, and the same horn made war with the saints and prevailed against them, until the Ancient of Days came, and judgment was given to the saints of the Most High, and the time came the saints possessed the kingdom. Praise Yah, this is what we're waiting for here. Thus he said the four, and that's why, right, the beast is still prevailing over people, killing people, imprisoning them, destroying them with chemicals, GMOs, all kind of sticking crud into people's arms, all kinds of stuff. Until the Ancient of Days come, and judgment was given to the saints of the Most High, and the time came that the saints possessed the kingdom. Thus he said, the fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom upon the earth, which shall be diverse from all the kingdoms, and shall devour the whole earth, and shall tread it down, and break it in pieces. And the 10 horns out of his kingdom are 10 kings that shall arise, and another shall arise after them, and he shall be diverse from the first, and he shall subdue 3 kings. This is, now this part here is talking about the papacy, the Roman Catholic Church. We discussed that right here in great detail about the papacy, the Vatican, the Roman Catholic Church, all here in this 22-minute video, Unlocked the Beast of Revelation. And he shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws, which the Vatican certainly has, or the papacy has. And they shall be given into his hand until a time and times and the dividing of time. But the judgment shall sit, and they shall take away his dominion to consume and to destroy until the end. And the kingdom and dominion and the greatness of the kingdom under the whole heaven shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High, whose kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominion shall serve and obey him. Praise Yah. And we've been speaking the last couple weeks about how to be on the right side of these things. And you know what it is? It's to be faithful and obedient with all of our heart, soul, and mind. Faithful in our belief and our confession and our repentance, and obedient according to the commandments of the Most High, the Torah of Elohim. Okay. Interesting rabbit holes. Now let's take a look at, let me close up some of these tabs here. All right. So let's take a look at Enoch 67. We're going to look at verse 4. And he will imprison those angels who have shown unrighteousness in that burning valley which my grandfather Enoch had formerly shown to me in the west, among the mountains of gold and silver and iron and soft metal and tin. So this is kind of confirming what we're talking about. And I saw to that valley, and I saw that valley in which there was a great convulsion and a convulsion of the waters. When all this took place from that fiery molten metal and from the convulsion thereof in that place, there was produced a smell of sulfur, and it was connected with those waters. And that valley of the angels who had led astray mankind burned beneath that land. And through its valleys proceeded streams of fire, where these angels are punished who had led astray those who dwell upon the earth. That's what they're doing. Just like, you know, again, making reference to like these Marvel characters, right? These Avengers, people are going to be like, oh, yeah, right? And bring, leading astray mankind, just like they did back in the day. But those waters shall in those days serve for the kings and the mighty and the exalted and those who dwell on the earth for the healing of the body, but for the punishment of the spirit, maybe even the prospering of the body, like physical material things, but for the punishment of the spirit. Now their spirit is full of lust, that they may be punished in their body, for they have denied Yahweh Sabaoth, and see their punishment daily, and yet believe not in his name. And in pro- proportion as the burning of their bodies becomes severe, a corresponding change shall take place in their spirit forever and ever. For before Yahweh Sabaoth, none shall utter an idle word, for the judgment shall come upon them, because they believe in the lust of their bodies and deny Yahweh Sabaoth. And those same waters will undergo a change in those days. For when those angels are punished in those waters, these water springs shall change their temperature. And when the angels ascend, this water of the spring shall change and become cold. Right, right. This the ascending out of the bottomless pit. Right. And I heard Michael answering and saying, this judgment wherewith the angels are judged is a testimony for the kings and mighty who possess the earth, because these waters of judgment minister to the healing of the body of the kings and the lust of their bodies. Therefore, they will not see and will not believe that those waters will change and become a fire which burns forever. Speaking of this burning here. Revelation 18, 1 through 9. And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and has become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird. For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues. For her sins have reached unto heaven, and Elohim has remembered her iniquities. What is the biblical definition of sin and iniquity? Well, we find it really easily here. 1 John 3:4. Whoever commits sin transgresses also the law, the Torah, for sin is the transgression of the law, the Torah. Reward her even as she rewarded you, and double unto her according to her works, in the cup which she has filled to her double. How much she has glorified herself and lived deliciously. Right, just like we saw in the Book of Enoch right here, these kings living lavishly. How much she has glorified herself and lived deliciously, so much torment and sorrow give her. For she says in her heart, I sit a queen and am no widow, and shall see no sorrow. Therefore shall her plagues come in one day, death and mourning and famine, and she shall be utterly burned with fire. For strong is Yahweh Elohim who judges her, and the kings of the earth who have committed fornication and lived deliciously with her shall bewail her and lament her when they shall see the smoke of her burning. So, do you want to be part of this burning? Do you want to be part of this destruction? Absolutely not. Of course not, brothers and sisters. So, lest we follow the error of these angels that have led astray mankind since the beginning. That's been the whole story, right? They came down and taught men and women how to sin and how to sin against the Most High. And men and women have loved this wickedness ever since day one. And here it is happening in the last days again. So like we said at the beginning, seven good mountains, seven bad mountains. So we spent quite a bit of time talking about the bad. Let's talk about the good. Isaiah 2, the future house of Elohim, the word which Isaiah, the son of Amoz, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. It shall come to pass in the latter days that the mountain of the house of Yahuwah shall be established as the highest of the mountains. And it shall be raised above the hills, and all nations shall flow to it. And many people shall come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of Yahuwah, to the house of the Elohim of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, and that we may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the Torah, the law, and the word of Yahuwah from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations, and shall decide for many peoples. And they shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war any more. O house of Jacob, come, let us walk in the light of Yahuwah. So, the mountain, New Jerusalem, will be nestled amongst the mountains. So, just like we saw in Enoch, going back to the good mountains, and I went beyond and saw seven magnificent mountains, all differing each from the other, and the stones thereof. Sorry, we're back at Enoch 24, which is the original point of this study. And I went beyond and saw seven magnificent mountains, all differing each from the other, and the stones there were magnificent and beautiful, magnificent as a whole, of glorious appearance and fair exterior, right? And the seventh mountain was in the midst of these mountains and excelled them in height, resembling the seat of a throne, and fragrant trees encircled them. So this is literally what we just read right here. It shall come to pass in the latter days that the mountain, the large one, the mountain of Yahuwah shall be established as the highest of the mountains. It's repeated in Micah 4, but we're going to read all of Micah 4 because it's just an awesome chapter. It shall come to pass in the latter days that the mountain of the house of Yahuwah shall be established as the highest of the mountains, and shall be raised above the hills, and people shall flow to it, and many nations shall come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of Yahuwah, to the house of the Elohim of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, and we may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law, the Torah, and the word of Yahuwah from Jerusalem. He shall judge between many peoples, and shall decide for strong nations afar off. And they shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war any more. But they shall sit every man under his vine and under his fig tree, and none shall make them afraid. For the mouth of Yahuwah Sabaoth has spoken. For all the peoples walk each in the name of his Elohim, but we will walk in the name of Yahuwah, our Elohim, forever and ever. In that day, says Yahuwah, I will assemble the lame and gather those who have been driven away and those whom I have afflicted. And the lame I will make the remnant, and those who are cast off a strong nation. And Yahuwah will reign over them in Mount Zion from this time forth and forevermore. Praise Yah. This is the kingdom that some people have said that has come and has gone away or disappeared or buried. He says it right here. When this comes, when the kingdom comes, right? He will reign over them in Mount Zion from this time and forevermore. Praise Yah. Still looking forward to this, brothers and sisters. And you, O tower of the flock, hill of the daughter of Zion, to you shall it come. The former dominion shall come, the kingdom of the daughter of Jerusalem. Now, why do you cry aloud? Is there no king in you? Has your counselor perished, that pangs have seized you like a woman in travail? Writhe and groan, O daughter of Zion, like a woman in travail, for now you shall go forth from the city and dwell in the open country. You shall go to Babylon, and there you shall be rescued. There Yahweh will redeem you from the hand of all your enemies, just like it will be in the last days. Now many nations are assembled against you, saying, let her be profaned, and let her eyes gaze upon Zion. But they do not know the thoughts of Yahuwah. They do not understand his plan, that he has gathered them as the sheaves to the threshing floor. And this is what we're talking about earlier. How are all the nations going to come against the kingdom of Elohim? How are they going to see this massive building or massive city, and they're going to be like, wow, we need to destroy this? Why wouldn't they be like, wow, this is amazing. Let's serve them. No, right? It's because I believe these angels are going to come and they're going to say, hey, look, the aliens, let's go get them. But they do not know the thoughts of Yahuwah. They do not understand his plan, that he has gathered them as the sheaves of the threshing floor. Arise and thresh, O daughter of Zion, right? The people of Israel, for I will make your horn iron and your hoofs bronze, and you shall beat in pieces many peoples, and you shall devote their gain to Yahuwah, their wealth to Yahuwah of the whole earth. Let's take a look at 2 Esdras 15-23. Mother, embrace your sons. Bring them up with gladness, as does the dove. Establish their feet, because I have chosen you, says Yahuwah. And I will raise up the dead from their places, and will bring them out from their tombs, because I recognize my name in them. Do not fear, mother of the sons, for I have chosen you, says Yahuwah. I will send you help, my servants Isaiah and Jeremiah. According to their counsel, I have consecrated and prepared for you 12 trees loaded with various fruits. And this is interesting. And the same number of springs flowing with milk and honey, and 7 mighty mountains on which roses and lilies grow. By these will I fill your children with joy. So it's interesting. We see here these trees and these mountains, very similar we just see here. And the seventh mountain was in the midst of these mountains, and it excelled them in height, resembling the seat of a throne, and fragrant trees encircled the throne. So we're getting a little interesting picture of what's going on here in the book of 2 Esdras. Now, you want to be part of this? Guard the rights of the widow, secure justice for the fatherless, give to the needy, defend the orphan, clothe the naked, care for the injured and the weak. This is all Torah. Do not ridicule a lame man. Protect the maimed, and let the blind man have a vision of my splendor. Protect the old and the young within your walls. When you find any who are dead, commit them to the grave and mark it, and I will give you the first place in my resurrection. Hallelujah. Let's take a look at Enoch 77. I'm not sure why I don't have this one, the link up here. Enoch 77. Oh, Roman numerals, 50, 60, 77. There you are. Enoch 77. Oh, here's the seven mountains again. And the first quarter, which is called the east, because it is the first, and the second, the south, because the Most High will descend there. Yea, there in quite a special sense he will, who is blessed forever and ever, descend. And the west quarter is named the diminished, because there all the luminaries of the heaven wane and go down. And the fourth quarter, named the north, is divided into these three parts. The first of them is for the dwelling of men, and the second contains seas of waters, and the abysses, and forests, and rivers, and darkness, and clouds. And the third part contains the garden of righteousness. I saw seven high mountains, higher than all the mountains which are on the earth, and from thence comes hoarfrost, and days, and seasons, and years pass away. I saw seven rivers on the earth, larger than all the rivers. One of them coming from the west pours its water into the great sea, and these two come from the north to the sea, and pour their waters into the Erythraean Sea. Which the Erythraean Sea, let's take a look at the Erythraean Sea. In times past, this is what the Erythraean Sea was called, which is, I guess, what you call the Indian Ocean. So we have seven mountains that pour waters into the Erythraean Sea and the Great Sea, which is over here, you'll see. The Great Sea, right? We saw this is the land of Israel right here. This is Egypt. This is Saudi Arabia. So there's a range of seven mountains which pour water into this great sea and the Erythraean Sea. So something sits right here and pours water here and pours water there. What's interesting about that is this is the Genesis 15 promised land, right? Which is not quite, it's a little bit shy of the dimensions given for New Jerusalem, which is 1,500 miles by 1,500 miles. This is roughly 1,200 miles by 1,200 miles, like a big square. But, you know, I wonder if there's some translational errors or whatnot. But it's interesting is that, you know, the Most High promised Abraham that these borders would be given to his descendants forever. Like, literally forever. This is where they're going to dwell forever. So, I don't think that the Most High would lie to Abraham. So I believe these seven mountains, which the highest being New Jerusalem, will be established into this area, to which it says, again, in Enoch here, these seven high mountains, which are higher than all the mountains which are on the earth, and from them, right, and so he saw seven rivers on the earth, larger than all the rivers, and it pours its waters into the Great Sea and into the Erythraean Sea. So, this, if it pours water here and here, it'd be pouring into the Erythraean Sea and to the Great Sea. So these seven mountains, right, are establishing New Jerusalem. And let's see, what else do we want to talk about? So these seven mountains, what do they actually represent? Well, we saw the seven bad mountains represented seven kings or seven princes of Hasatan. So what would these seven good mountains represent? Because there's a literal sense and there's a figurative sense. So the literal sense, well, it's the seven mountains of the kingdom of New Jerusalem. In the figurative sense, well, if the seven bad mountains we're talking about seven commanders or princes or kings of Hasatan, well, what would that be in the good sense? Revelation 1:4, John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace be unto you and peace from him which is and which was and which is to come, from the seven spirits which are before his throne. So remember these seven churches, right? And then we'll drop down here to verses 12 through 20. And I turned to see the voice that spake with me, and being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks. And in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks is one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and girt about with the paps of the golden girdle. His head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire, and his feet like unto fine brass, as if they burned in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. And of course, this is talking about Messiah, right? So Messiah basically walks in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. And he had in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was as the sun shines in his strength. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. And he laid his right hand upon me, saying unto me, Fear not, I am the first and the last. I am he that lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. I have the keys of hell and death. Write the things which you have seen, and the things which are, and the things which shall be hereafter. The mystery of the seven stars which you saw in my right hand, and the seven golden candlesticks. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven candlesticks which you saw are the seven churches. So you have seven angels which are over the seven ecclesia, the seven assemblies. And so, what is New Jerusalem? New Jerusalem is the formation of his people. And you have seven leaders, these seven angels, right? Revelation 2:1, unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things says he that holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. So Messiah himself walks amongst it. He isn't one of the seven leaders. He is over the seven leaders of that church. So just like the beast kingdom has his seven heads, right? Or his seven mountains. Yahusha and his kingdom has seven mountains. Right? He walks in the midst of these seven. So remember, in Enoch 18 and 19, it describes the seven burning mountains as angels. It just so happens, Enoch 18 and 19, it just so happens to discuss the seven archangels of Elohim. Let's name them again. Let's read about them again. Chapter 20. And these are the names of the holy angels who watch. Uriel, one of the holy angels who is over the world and over Tartarus. Raphael, one of the holy angels who is over the spirits of men. Raguel, one of the holy angels who takes vengeance on the world of the luminaries. Michael, one of the holy angels, to wit, he that is set over the best part of mankind and over chaos. Sarakiel, one of the holy angels who is set over the spirits, who sent in the spirit. Gabriel, one of the holy angels who is over paradise and the serpents and the cherubim. Remiel, one of the holy angels, to wit, whom Elohim set over those who rise. So what am I? So this is a long rabbit trail, but I wanted to be thorough. I like being thorough on these things. No need to just scratch the surface on these things. So I wanted this to be an in-depth study. So long story short, I do believe that we can conclude that the seven mountains represent seven angels or seven princes or seven kings, but these kings specifically are spiritual entities, not human kings. So seven mountains, seven angels, depending on which kingdom you're looking at, the kingdom of light or the kingdom of darkness. The kingdom of light has the seven archangels. The kingdom of darkness has his seven, Satan has his seven not so good angels. So with that, brothers and sisters, I pray that some of this might have been a blessing for you. Next week, we are going to go through chapters 25 through 36. We're actually going to cover quite a bit. And then after that, really excited to get into the parables. It's actually interesting. The parables of Enoch was literally the dream I had that made me stop everything I was doing to get back into the book of Enoch. It was literally... where's my phone? I'll read you my dream. Why not? Let me read you my dream here. All right. When was this? This was back in September 17th of this year. I was in some sort of business or establishment. I was there to teach new people the truth. There was another teacher slated to be there at 12:30 p.m., but he did not show up because of the raging storm outside. Before it was time to teach, lunch came and it was full of fast food, burgers and fries and chicken sandwiches. I decided to only grab the fried zucchini because I didn't want to eat any tainted meat. Whatever. When it was time to teach, so I'm sitting in front of the class now, standing in front of the class. When it was time to teach, I let everyone know that we were going to do a Torah portion study. But everyone was puzzled. They were all looking at me like, what's a Torah portion study? But everyone was puzzled, and I remembered that they were brand new. So then I asked everyone to turn to the first parable of Enoch in chapter 30-something, which is chapter 37. The storm outside was massive, but I could have cared less. I woke up, and I was like, whoa, I need to get back into Enoch. And thus, this study was started in many other shorter studies we've done on TikTok and YouTube Shorts. So with that, brothers and sisters, let's end with prayer and a couple songs. Heavenly Father, Yahuwah, we bless you and come before you in Yahushua's name. And we thank you, Father, for opening our eyes to truth in these last days. None of us are worthy, Father. But through your Son, Messiah Yahushua, we may be found worthy. We pray to be found worthy, just like it says in the book of Luke, that we pray always to be counted worthy to escape these things that are coming to pass and to stand before the Son of Man. Father, we pray to be worthy of such an honor, Father. We pray to be listed amongst the inhabitants of New Jerusalem, your kingdom, Father. That is the goal of this ministry, as you know. And I pray for those that would listen. Father, would you continue to give us wisdom? If there is any wisdom found in this study, Father, we know it's from you. If there's any errors, we know it was from me, Father. We love you, we bless you, and thank you for doing all the wonderful things you do for us, Father. And we thank you for the Shabbat, your feast days, for your whole Torah, so that we know what is good and pleasing in your sight. Father, we love you, and we lift you up, and we bless you, and we just ask for your deliverance for us on this earth, Father. And we ask that you, Messiah Yahushua, come and gather his people. We love you. And say amen, amen, hallelujah, and Shabbat shalom, brothers and sisters. Shabbat shalom to you, and look forward to seeing you next week as we finish up and get ready for the three parables of Enoch. So with that, we are going to do a couple songs. What are we going to do? Let's do first the priestly blessing.
Peace. understand me, set me free, protect me from the snare of all my enemies. Hear my plea, one above enthroned upon eternity. You can see as I journey through death's darkened valley. Rise up now and make the wicked flee from me. Save me from the time of trouble that they bring.
Rise up now and make the wicked flee from me.
The land of sin, lightnings flash from east to west. He has come for those he led. Riding on the cherubim, he will cleanse the land of sin. Lightnings flash from east to west. He has come for those he led. Righteous warriors of the word, light your candles, grab your swords, start the fight, stand in the night, destroy the darkness with his light. Lightnings flash from east to west, he has come for those he left. Riding on the chariot,
satisfy you, no. Come, he says, oh, come, he says, for those who thirst and hunger, oh, yeah. He told you what is good, oh, man, but to walk before him humbly and confess his son, the way, the truth, and the life. He is the fountain of life. Yahusha HaMashiach. Faithful servant, so all I want to do is your will. For where your hand is, so all we want to hear is well done. My faithful servants, so all we want to do is your will. For where Shalom.